On today's Fast Friday, I'm going to show you exactly how the Fujifilm HDR feature works. And Fuji is doing a few strange things with this HDR. Let's get started. Hi everyone, welcome to Pal to Tech. HDR is a feature that is currently available on the Fujifilm X-T4, X100V, and X-Pro3 series of cameras. HDR stands for High Dynamic Range. In the past, HDR has kind of gotten a bad reputation. Just go to Google Image Search and do a search for HDR vomit photos, and you'll see how HDR was so overused in the past by the Instagram crowd. Well, times are changing, and people are learning not to overdo it, and that HDR is another tool that can be carefully applied based on the specific creative needs. And so Fujifilm now included an actual HDR setting right at the top of the camera. Here's how it works. When you set your dial to HDR, whenever you go to press the shutter button, your camera will immediately take three photos at once. Each photo is going to have a different exposure. The first will use the exposure settings you made at the time you took your shot. The second photo will be underexposed, and the third photo will be overexposed. Then the camera will merge together these three photos into one photo and then save it to the SD card. Whenever you play back a saved HDR image on your camera, you'll see this little icon here that shows you it is an HDR processed image. Now, there's some weirdness going on with what HDR is doing to your RAW files and how they're affected. We'll discuss that in a bit. But for now, just remember that HDR will always save a JPEG file unless you have your camera set to shoot both JPEG and RAW. In that case, you will get one RAW file and one JPEG. The RAW file will have the same exposure settings that you had set at the time you took your shot, while the JPEG will be the merged photo from the three different exposure files that were originally created before it was saved to the SD card. Let's take a look at how this works. You're going to want to go into the camera icon in your Fujifilm menu right here under Drive Setting. Scroll down, you'll see HDR mode. There are six settings that you can make with HDR. The first is on or off, right? You just simply turn the dial and that sets it on or off. The other five settings are right in your menu here. Now, 200 to 800% allows you to specify the amount of over and under exposure that's applied when the camera takes those extra shots. 200% sets it to one stop of exposure and is the minimum amount that you can set your HDR for. 400% is two stops of exposure, and 800% is three stops of exposure. Now, auto allows the camera to choose an exposure setting between 200% and 800%. Now, the final one is 800%. Plus. All Fuji has to say about that is that camera settings are adjusted for maximum variation in dynamic range. That's not an explanation. That's like, you know what that's like? That's like an airplane bouncing around in heavy turbulence, you know, and then the pilot gets on the PA and says, "It's a bit bumpy back there. We're in the process of adjusting our wing flaps for maximum variation in altitude range." There's no other information that I was able to find from Fuji on this thing. Nothing. So based on my testing, I concluded that 200% to 400% will give you roughly what you would get setting the DR to 200 and 400%, while 800% plus is the same as using D range priority set to strong. For more details about dynamic range and D range priority settings, please see my videos on those topics. What's very interesting about HDR though, is that unlike the DR setting or the dynamic range priority setting, you are not forced to use a minimum ISO. In the case of the X-T4, you can use the base ISO of 160 of the camera. So let's take a look at what you get with the HDR feature. So for this first shot right here, this is what the camera told me would be good exposure. For this next shot, I enabled HDR and set it to 200%. That would be one stop of over or under exposure for those bracketed shots it's going to merge. And as you can see, there's almost no difference at all. Maybe just a smidgen more detail in the highlights. Next, let's test HDR 400. Here, photo on the left has no HDR, photo on the right has HDR set to 400. and I can definitely see some recovery in these highlights. However, nothing much in the shadows. Like the 200%, it pretty much looks the same. Now we come to 800%. Have a look at this. There's definitely some changes in my highlights, but I'm not sure I really like them. They're kind of flat. You see that right there? Let's look at the shadows now. I can kind of make out a bit more detail in the shadows, but again, I'm surprised at how little the shadows are affected. All right, let's bring out the big one now, 800% plus. Let's have a look. Well, right away, you can see there's a huge difference. The photo shot with 800% plus HDR is much less contrasty. You see that right there? Look at the shadow detail. Interesting though, again, it has this kind of muddy look to it. Look at this. You know, sometimes it's not the end of the world to blow a few highlights. I actually like the background in the non-HDR version than in the HDR version 800+. Let's take a look at the shadows now. Okay, no doubt about it. If you want shadow detail, HDR 800% plus is where you want to go. Let's zoom in at 200, see if there's any noise. Not really. And I attribute that to the fact that you don't have to turn up the ISO like you do in dynamic range and D-range priority settings. But there is still kind of, and I'm gonna keep calling a muddiness, but there's still a flat muddiness, I think, to these photos using HDR 800% plus. Let's talk about the RAW files that are generated when you shoot in HDR mode. When you open them up in Lightroom, they look identical. And when you open them up in Capture One, there's definitely some color differences that unfortunately I didn't have time to spend hours digging into. However, let's go with the assumption that the RAW files are pretty much the same with regard to what you can do in post-production, and that the JPEG files, therefore, really are what you are using the HDR setting to create. So now, pal the tech, you awesome YouTuber, you ask, why are the RAW files so much larger when you shoot in HDR mode? What? The regular Fujifilm RAW files average around 60 megabytes. However, have a look at the RAW file for the HDR mode. It's almost three times the size at 163 megabytes. Why would the same RAW file with the same resolution and the same settings be three times the size? Three times the size. Three. Three. Get it? Three photos. Three times the size. It turns out that these RAW files actually contain three separate photos inside the single RAW file. So included inside the original RAW file is the first photo that you shot, which is based on the exposure settings at the time you took the photo. Then there is a second photo that is underexposed by however many stops you had when you set HDR, right? And then there's a third photo, which is overexposed. The sensor data, okay? The sensor data for all three photos is contained inside that single RAW file. However, when you open up that single RAW file in Lightroom, Photoshop, Capture One, and so forth, it is only seen as one file, and only the data in the first third of the RAW file is used and displayed. It turns out that there is an official name for this kind of Fujifilm file. It is officially called the Fujifilm HDR RAW. But it gets even stranger. Have a look at this page on the official Adobe website. Apparently, there is a setting that you can make whereby you convert the Fujifilm HDR RAW into an Adobe DNG file. You have to be in the library module and you select the photo you want to convert, go up to library, and then choose convert photo to DNG. You'll see a dialog box come up. Have a look at this. In the dialog box, there will be a checkbox that says embed original RAW file. Go ahead and check that, and when you do, supposedly, Adobe will include all three. It will take information from all three of those RAW files inside your one RAW file and produce a DNG from that. I ran some tests doing this, and unfortunately, I found absolutely no difference in converting a Fujifilm HDR RAW file to an Adobe DNG file using the embedded original options checkbox selected or not selected. In both cases, the resulting images look the same to me. This is the part of the video where I have to tell you, I have to stop. I've been doing a lot of thinking about this, and I either need to do YouTube full time for you, which would be great because then it would free up lots of other time for me to be able to test this kind of stuff, or I'm just gonna have to continue calling it quits at this point in the video because I run out of time to do all this testing. I'd almost prefer the first option though, but I need to come up with a way to actually make that work. Right. Anyhow, before I end this video, let me give you some very important tips and some information that you should know when shooting HDR on Fujifilm. The first is that you should always keep the camera steady when shooting HDR. Preferably, the camera should be on a tripod. Same with subject motion. Be very careful with this. You are not going to want to shoot an HDR image of a high-speed train racing down a track, because if you do, you'll get ghosting and other problems. Number three, HDR will not work with a flash. So, sorry, no flash. Number four, HDR will give you a slight crop and an upsampling of the resolution in the image. Have a look at this. You see, here's an image that is not HDR, and you see how it fills the frame? And here's what happens when I set the camera to HDR. You see how it changes? It zooms in a little bit, it crops it a little bit. Number five, when you're shooting HDR and you have the setting set to 800% plus, be very careful as your images could turn out to be muddy and flat. I have a little suggestion for you. Before you go to shoot HDR 800% plus, go into IQ and set your sharpness to +2 and your clarity to +3. Have a look at this. Image on the left was shot with HDR 800 plus, and the image on the right was shot with HDR 800 plus, but with those settings to sharpness and clarity that I told you about. See that? It just looks a little bit better and has more of the original contrast in the version here without the HDR. So it kind of helps you to get the best of both worlds. The bottom line on HDR is that because your Fujifilm camera also gives you dynamic range and the D-range priority setting options, I'm not so sure the HDR function is even necessary, except for maybe shooting with perhaps a lower ISO value. HDR is a very interesting feature on the camera, and I would love to spend some more time playing around with it. If you know of any information about the ability to read out those three hidden RAW files inside the main RAW file, be sure to let us know in the comments below. Well, thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed the video, and if you did, be sure to give it the like and subscribe. Be sure to get out this weekend if you can and shoot some HDR, play around with it, have fun with it, and I will be signing off now. I will see you in another video next week. Take care.